Hello and welcome back to a new tutorial here in my Diabetix 12 video series on YouTube. Today we're going to talk about commentless-commentless dependencies, so how to link two commentless together so that they show a dependency onto each other, and we will actually also explain some examples and also why we need that. So we will start directly after the intro. So before we talk about the implementation and the concept itself, we have to talk about why we need that. Why we need some dependency between lists, because dependencies are always not great. If you have dependency, that always means you have to do something before something else, and that is not quite nice. Actually, we do have some kind of like dependency already by using fence values and weight signal, weight conditions, and also to use some, for example, weight directly on a comment queue. But for now, we already only did a weight for weight objects, but now we have to do some weights on queues, and also we have to stage these queue weights. So the main problem is that when a comment list is not executed, we don't have a fence value, so we cannot deduce onto which value another queue has to wait, or even maybe it's executed on the same queue type, so it's both a 3D job. And so we actually need to order things, that the first DD shop executes first and then the second one executes. Well, normally on DirectX 11 this was no problem, because you could just execute the one thing and then the other thing. You could also do this in DirectX 12. It's actually also written in some books which talk about DirectX 12. They actually do that like this. So they do it after each other like you would do it in DirectX 11. But when you do that, you will not actually use all capabilities of the API, and actually your program will probably be slower, because, well, you have the DirectX 12, okay, you have a less driver overhead and a less DirectX overhead, but if you just use it the DirectX 11 approach, then you lose all parallelism and optimizations DirectX 11 was doing or trying to figure out automatically. And so we need to use a more better concept. But before we come to the concept on how to parallelize things, I want to first give you an example, and then we're gonna parallelize this example on the CPU side. So the example in our case will be a terrain rendering. So terrain is just your landscape, all your hills, all your mountains, all your valleys, all your, let's say, stream, I don't know, is it called stream bed? The part in the landscape where a stream, a river, flow through. I don't know, is it called bed? The kind of like thing where it lies into. I know in German it's called like this, I'm not quite sure, but you get the point. You model the landscape in a terrain system. So the final thing you want is the frame buffer, which will include your nice terrain. And for rendering the terrain, you need several information. Of course, you need some kind of textures. You need some images that represents, for example, that hills have snow on the top, and then when you go lower, then you have rocks, and if you go even more lower, you get grass, and maybe if you go very, very, let's say you are on an island, if you go a bit lower to the sea level, you first get sand for the beach, and when you go lower again, then you have all the underwater texture. So kind of like some textures that define how the landscape looks like, for example in several heights, or you could even have a more sophisticated system that automatically checks if a hill is very steep, that it will not generate grass there, but it will generate maybe some rocks and dirt, so because the grass was not able to grow there because it was so steep. So you can do actually quite some nice algorithm that do calculations, but you need at some point the texture, and we already talked about height. So on a specific point, the terrain has a specific height, and this height needs to be defined somewhere, and most time this height will be defined in a so-called height map, so a map which shows the height. And you actually need these two things to render a terrain. You need the height map and you need the texture. So in a 3D pass, you put in the textures, the terrain texture and the height map texture, and you can then use a 3D call to render this terrain. But the height map will not come out of nothing. You need to give it to the GPU in some way. So there are actually two main options for terrain rendering. One is artist authored, so the artists will draw where are the hills, where is the valley, and all that other stuff. And the other option is the procedural generator terrain. So you have an algorithm which defines or which randomly generates where are the hills, where is the valley and all that other stuff. But in this case we want to use it in a procedural way. So we have a generator, and this will be done by a compute operation because it doesn't need some 3D rendering stuff. It just generates for each entry in the height map, it will generate the height according to a function. Maybe itself uses some noise textures or stuff like that, but we will just use a very basic example here, and we'll just say that we just need some parameters which define the terrain generator. So most of the time it will be at least a seed, and most of the times also some parameterization. So if you want a more hilly environment, you maybe add a hilly tag, and if you want it more flat, you add a flat tag, or you use two parameters, hilly and flat, and you can make crossfade across them. If you have 1.0 you have hilly, if you have 0.0 you have nearly no hill. And yeah, you need some kind of data to or some kind of configuration for the compute operation to define the terrain, and that's actually what we have. It's called a buffer because it is kind of like a buffer is a struct, or a buffer can contain structs, one or many, or even an array of a type struct, so multiple elements of a struct, and it just contains the configuration for the in this case compute job. So you would need to compute the height map, but also this terrain generation data will also don't fly magically in the GPU, so you need to copy this from, let's say, a configuration file, so a file you have already opened up in memory, to the GPU. So you have a copy, a compute, and a 3D call. And in DirectX 11 this was very easy. You would just say, okay, if not on GPU, then copy, step one. If a player has moved, determine which tiles of the terrain, because the terrain is always split into tiles, which tile of the terrain needs to be updated, and then compute 0 to n of the updated tiles. So step two, compute. After the compute was done, you would then just go without any if or else. You would just say, okay, then now stage all 3D calls and draw in 3D. So we have three steps which are done in sequence. First copy, compute, and draw. And this is actually how it should be executed on the GPU. On the GPU there is no alternative, it has to be in this exact order. Okay, the copy will be only required once execution, because I don't think that while you're playing a level the terrain generator will change its input parameters, because it will then create some seams and some very ugly looking things, so they should be stay the same in one level. The compute is not always executed, but as soon as you move, as soon as you go away or move closer to the, let's say, west of your game, when you move to the west, you have to actually generate all tiles that are now coming into sight by moving west, and you have to dispose all tiles in the east, because you will not longer need the east tiles when you move west. So there's some kind of logic. It's not called every frame, but it's called occasionally. But 3D is required every frame. And this is actually where we, as a graphic programmer, see some optimizations, because we see that compute is less frequency called than 3D draw, and copy is even lower frequency called than compute. So actually see, why should I always evaluate or why should I always waste time evaluating all that stuff? And actually, we do need to waste this time, because we need to check if there comes something in space, but we can optimize that by parallelizing this thing. So if you put the 3D in one thread, the compute in one thread, and the copy in one thread on the CPU side, they could independently from each other execute, check if they need to be run at all, or if they don't need to be run at all, and they will then just check what is going on. So we could parallelize this in three threads, but this will actually arise some problems, because we in some case need to, or at one point in our application we need to parallelize it again, because we need to stage it for not parallelize it, serialize it again, because we need to stage it on the GPU, and the GPU works in series. And this is actually a problem, because imagine that we are currently still doing our compute stuff, because actually compute I think will be the most expensive step on the CPU side. The 3D is actually quite fixed function. You could just always just bind the same stuff. You could actually put this into a so-called bundle, which is just staged every time. So the 3D will be very, very fast on the CPU side. You will just have to update the new player position and then call all the set, all the states and say render. So this should be the fastest one on the CPU side. Actually, the copy is the fastest one, but actually copy is the fastest one. Second fastest would be 3D, and third fastest, or last fastest, or slowest, better to say in this case, would be the compute on the CPU side. It could vary, but this was what I would suspect. But it should, it could be even different. But actually, I doubt that the compute will be the fastest one. I think it is the slowest one. So let's just imagine the 3D is already done, staging all comments on the comment list. Now in this case you would execute the comment list because you're done on the thread, but this arises a problem because before we execute and queue this on the GPU, we actually have to queue the compute stuff because we need an actually dedicated fence value to depend onto that compute queue. And this is what I call a weak dependency because it is a fence value. You don't know if it relates to any other comment queue or comment list. You don't just know, okay, for this fence I have to wait. I have to wait until this fence gets this value. So it's a weak dependency, but it's a dependency that our GPU understands. So our GPU in this case only understands, or even at all on the on our GPU only understands weak dependencies. But what we actually need are strong dependencies. We need a dependency that directly say, okay, the 3D comment list can only be executed when this specific compute comment list is executed. And on the other case, in the compute queue, we need a strong dependency and say this compute queue has can only be executed if this copy queue has executed. And these are what I call weak and strong dependencies. So actually, I would call them like this. And we kind of like need a way to insert them, inject them to each other, resolve dependencies, execute raw calls recursively in case a dependency gets resolved and it triggers a kind of like recursive or a domino effect recursion. So for example, the 3D depends on the compute depends on the copy. Let's just say the copy is the one that takes the most CPU time. So in case the copy is already finished executing, when the copy queue starts executing, we then need to recursively say, okay, now also start compute, now also start 3D. Actually, we would not necessarily need such a dependency system. We could actually just do, okay, record all 3D stuff, pause the thread until compute is done, do all in the compute thread, do all the compute stuff, pause the thread until copy is done. But this is not very nice, and we will have a lot of jobs in our job system that are just waiting for other lists to finish. So in this case, I just want to have this recursively and be done by the last one in the dependency chain that is executed, so that it recursively goes down and we don't have too many state switches in our job system, and that our job is runs the least amount of time, which will be the most efficient in this case. So this is what we kind of like try to archive. Actually, this is not only an advantage on the DirectX side or on our usability of our framework, this is actually also an advantage in case of system design, because just remember, what is the goal of terrain rendering? Well, we want to draw a 3D terrain onto our scene. But actually, we don't care how it is drawn. We may have actually several different variants how it is drawn. Maybe in an editor, I want to visualize the height by drawing height lines. And maybe you have seen height lines in a map. So every time you switch between, let's say, 100 height meters or let's say 20 height meters, you draw another line. And according to how close the lines are together and how frequent the lines are, you can actually tell how high is the hill by just looking at the 2D map. Well, it is not as required on a 3D system because you can see the 3D dimensions, but it may be desirable to do such a rendering, or you have kind of like a card visualization where you have a 3D card where like the plane flies over like in the Indiana Jones movies, but not in the 2D side, but you have it in 3D and you want to use the same terrain, like you fly into it, so you fly through this card and you see the height lines and a nice little styled rendering, and then you go down and the map blends from the art style, like card style, into the realistic view. So in this case you would actually have to have two implementations for the rendering algorithm, and you can actually have several of them. You can write multiple of them, but actually, if you have these two things, generate and draw coupled and hard programmed, this is a bit of a pain to do. So what you would do, you would create. I will just cut off copy because copy will be done by a dedicated resource memory. So I will just yet now look at compute and draw, or better to say, produce terrain. So we have a terrain producer. We don't care how it is produced. We just get a height map out of the producer, and we have a 3D draw. We don't know, or 3D draw, or also I will call it terrain consumer. We don't care how this is implemented. We just know that it takes the height map and does something with that. So the common interface between these two interfaces is the height map. So actually multiple height maps, because you would have tiles and but this is a bit too far, too deep in. So the common interface is, let's say, the height map. Let's stay at singular here. So the height map is the common interface. So we have a common interface, which is the height map that defines the interface between them two. And you have the compute or the produce terrain interface, and you have the consume terrain interface. And what you now have to do, you have to find two implementations for each of two implementations, and exactly one of them. So for example, compute could be done in, or produce could be done in, two different steps. For example, one would be the same as we described here. We will generate it procedurally. Another option would be that we load it from disk. So we use it to load a file into memory and then upload it to GPU, and it has the artist authored terrain height map. And on the 3D side, the consumer side, I already told you two implementations, like the card style, RTX style, map style, not card, map style, and on the other side, the realistic style. And the nice thing is that you now can mix and match them together like you want. So you could say, for example, oh, now, because I have a tutorial level, which is always the same, I use the artist authored height map. But use the stylistic style while scrolling in, and as soon as I'm scrolled or flight in into the 2D terrain, I switch to the realistically looking terrain, or blend smoothly between them while I'm flying in. And this could be actually done, well, then you would actually need to define two interfaces and a blending factor, but I think you get the point. So, but let's stick just to that, and after you fly it in, you have all the realistic stuff, then you create your own level, then I need the procedural interface for the producer, and I need again the other tools for flying in and then playing. So you see, we are quite flexible when we are using this system that we are created. And actually, if we have a job system in the next video, I will implement this in the meantime, and we can overload, we can write the interface, which is actually a job. We can fill it with data and put some other features in that, and by implementing the producer and consumer interface, we actually have a ready to execute job for our job system later on. But so this will be a very, very nice interface, and you can do some really magic with that, because programming is always awesome. So I already told you the solution to do all that fancy stuff. I already told you before. We need to add dependencies, or better to say, strong dependencies, unresolved dependencies, from a comment list to another comment list. Let's just quickly summarize the type of dependencies that I have defined. So we have two types. The one is our strong dependencies. I already told you what a strong dependency is. This is actually a comment list to comment list dependency. So I actually know this comment list is dependent from that. Actually, an implementation will be a bit different, but we at least have a direct link between two comment lists. So we know, okay, these comment lists are directly related. But the problem we have there, this is why I called it unresolved dependencies, is that we have no fence value. We have just a pointer to another comment list. This comment list may not have been executed for now, and so we have no fence value we can actually wait for. So we actually can't execute the comment list that has a dependency to the other comment list, because the other comment list has not been executed. On the other side, we have the weak dependencies. These are just dependencies with specific values. So we just know this fence should be that value. It's a very weak dependency because we can't really tell where it is coming from which to which comment list was that originating. Okay, we know which comment list is affected by that, but we don't know from which comment list this is coming. So this is kind of like a weak dependency, but it is a resolved dependency. It is dependency to a specific fence value, so we actually know how to execute that kind of like dependency, how to translate that dependency to the GPU, but we have no idea where it is coming from. And just to summarize, on the one case, we have a nice dependency and no anything. It's a strong dependency, but we have no fence value. We can't execute it. This is unresolved. As soon as we resolve it, we have a weak dependency. We don't know where it is originating from, but we have resolved it. We know how to execute this. And yeah, this is actually the thing we finally want to achieve with our system. We want to go from strong to weak. We first have a strong dependency because this is like what we can understand. We know, okay, this list requires this other list. So this is a strong dependency. We will inject that dependency. And after the like dependent list is executed, or the list we are depending on is executed, it will notify us and say, hey, I have been executed. These are my values. Now you can make out of that strong dependency a weak dependency. Actually, you could then say, well, why not just keep the strong dependency? Actually, we will not keep them because they are reverse. But what I mean with reverse, we will come up in a few seconds or minutes. So how does this works? Actually, the only thing we have to change is the execute function. Okay, we have to do some a bit of a helper functions and the injection function, and we have to put some other things around in our framework, but not too much. Actually, the main changes are only the access object and in the list itself. And the only thing, or the main thing we are changing, is the execute function. Well, there are actually two cases. One case is we have no dependencies or no unresolved dependencies. We only have weak dependencies. We know how to execute them. We don't have strong dependencies. We have, though they are not resolved. Or better to say, we don't have any unresolved dependencies. This is actually the main point. First of all, because we have some resolved dependencies and weak dependency, we need to take them into account. We have to signal, we have to actually tell the queue to wait for these fence values to make sure that they passed. After this, we can safely execute our list on the queue, and we can also signal a new value to our related fence. And this is actually the case where we now have transitioned our current list that we are executing into a list state, where we can actually tell all dependents, or so all lists that depend on the list currently executed, we can now, because we have executed and we have a fence value, we can now tell them, hey, I have that value. So just go into a dependent, or go into an undependent state, resolve your dependencies to that value. That's actually what we do in the last step. We use the fence as execution value to resolve the dependencies on the other lists. This will be actually a max function, because we need to pick the max value. So if we have two dependencies going to the same fence, we need to wait for the bigger one, because the bigger one was later executed, and we need to wait until all data is available. Now there's also another thing that can happen when we execute a list. Actually, another thing can happen is that we have open dependencies. We have unresolved dependencies, and this means actually that the list cannot be executed yet. So we just have to directly return from our execute function, which arises a problem, because if we return from our execute function, we still give it back to the comment list manager, so we don't have any reference to that, and this will actually mean that we need to do execution recursively. So actually, in this step up here, when we have no open dependencies, when we resolve the dependencies and the dependency go to zero, so another list has been finally totally resolved, so there are no unresolved dependencies left, this list will automatically be executed recursively. And to better understand how this all works, I have a graphic for you. So this is just a effective workload here, so no practical stuff behind here, just some very basic examples. So it all starts here at the X comment list 1. This is executed in thread number 1. So what it then does, before it starts recording, it will say, okay, kick off the two other jobs I need. So it will create a new thread and give this thread the X comment list 2. After this thread has now been, let's say, prepared, it may not be executed now, but it is prepared and staged for execution, the comment list 1 returns and now has to set the dependency on that other list. So the X comment list 1 will call a function on the X comment list 2 and say, hey, my name is xCommentList1 and I'm dependent on you. What then the xCommentList2 can do, it can put a pointer on the CommentList1, because this makes things, when resolving dependencies, much more easier if you go the other way around. So this is the important step. If list1 is dependent on list2, it will be stored in a list in the list2. So a pointer list in list2, an array in list2 will store a pointer to the list1, because as soon as this is executed, it then can follow the pointer to resolve the dependencies on the list1. This is very important. It is kind of like reverse. Actually, you would may think that the pointer goes from 1 to 2 because 1 is dependent of 2, but actually the pointer is from 2 to 1 because of that. So what just then goes on, it stores this pointer to list1, and then it tells, okay, list1, I have received your request. You have now I have now a dependency, or you have now the dependency on me, increment your dependency count. And then this dependency count, DC stands for dependency count, will increment. Before it was 0, now it will be 1. But comment list2 is not just enough. The comment list1, or the thread1, will actually start another thread, the thread3, and will give it comment list3. It will do the same thing to comment list3 as it does to the comment list2. So it will call the comment list3 and tell it, hey, my name is comment list1 and I am dependent on you. And the comment list3 will then put in its list a pointer to comment list1 and tells the comment list1, hey, comment list1, I understand you, increment your dependency count. So now the dependency count gets incremented from 1 to 2. After that, the thread 1 can do its real work, it will record some comments, and it will finally reach the level where it will call execute. On execute, it will just check, hey, is my dependency count 0? No, it is 2, that is not 0. So just return. Now the thread 1 would actually exit and do some other work. But the comment list 1 is not executed, but it is still referenced by two other comment lists. So two comments lists will have the opportunity to later on, as soon as it is the right time, execute the comment list one. But it is not the right time, because comment list two itself has also another dependency. It requires another job, so it will execute on start thread 4, and then on thread 4, it will create a comment list 4 and tell the comment list 4, hey, my name is comment list 2, I'm dependent on you. So comment list store itself will store again a point on the comment list 2, and the comment list 2 will increment its dependency count to 1, from 0 to 1. Well, now the comment list 2 would do all the same stuff like comment list 1, would do some execution, queuing, and everything itself, and finally execute it or try executing it, but it will also fail because the dependency count is 1, so it fails and does nothing. At the other point, comment list 3 and 4 don't have any dependencies, so they can record their comments and execute straight away. So in the next step, comment list 3 and 4 would be finally executed and staged on the GPU, one in the copy and one in the compute for this example. What they now need to do is resolve dependencies, because they are executed now, and they now have the possibility to resolve one strong dependency to a weak dependency, to a resolved one, onto its comment list that depend on it. So for example, the comment list 3, let's say it has been executed with a fence value of 5. So the comment list 3 would follow this pointer back to comment list 1 and says, hey, comment list 1, resolve your dependency to fence value 5 on the compute fence. So this would mean that the dependency count here now could be decremented on 1 because it got one resolve call. And still, the dependency count is bigger than 0, so there would be no execute, and the thread 3 would exit as well. So now thread 3 and thread 1 are exited. Actually, thread 1, 2, and 3 are now exited and are done with its work. The only thread still alive is the thread 4, and what it does, it also has executed something. So it follows its pointer to the comment list 2 and says, hey, comment list 2, execute. You can now, or no, it says, hey, comment list 2, I have been executed to a fence value of 16 on the copy queue. So then the comment list 2 would say, okay, yes, I stored that dependency, and would then decrement its ref count. And actually now there's something nice happening, because now this comment list 2 has a dependency count of 0, which means that thread 4 will now automatically execute the comment list 2 because the dependency count is 0. So in the next step, the comment list 2 would be executed. And for example, on the compute queue with a fence value of 8. And now it recursively goes on, because we are in a called execute again, and this will always recursively call resolve again. So this would now check, okay, the comment list 1 is dependent on me, so it would go to comment list 1 and tell comment list 1, hey, comment list, resolve your dependency to a compute queue with a fence value of 8. Now the comment list 1 would say, okay, great, I got a weight value of 8, I already gotten weight value to 5, which is the bigger value, okay, it is 8, so I will store 8 on the compute fence and decrement my reference count, which is now 0, which means that thread 4 now can recursively call execute on the commit list one, even through this now travel to 4, 2, and now finally is at 1. And now compute queue or compute list one can be executed and will return to the 2, and the 2 will return to the 4, and then the thread number 4 could finally exit. And the recursion is finished, and we have all comment lists been executed and staged in the right order on the GPU. Well, a bit complicated, but I hope you got the point, but maybe it will be a bit more clear if we go onto the code base. Well, maybe I should warn you, because it is also not the most easiest code to understand, but if you understand the concept now, you should be all right. Before we take a look at all the stuff I have implemented this video, we first have to take a short look at concurrent programming, so programming with multiple threads, so synchronizing, actually multiple thread programming or multi-thread programming, concurrent programming is more about synchronizing the threads and controlling access than keeping in mind the parallelism itself, but it helps. So I have implemented one thing in the vendor. This is actually kind of like a header I will definitely reuse in future projects, and this is called the log tools header. The log tools header includes the log interface as well as three classes that helps dealing with logs and guarding objects with logs. So basically just a quick concept here in concurrent programming. A log is an object which can be only held by one thread at a time. So the call to acquire will only, if called at the same time, will only succeed for one thread, the first thread actually accessing the memory bus. So there are special instructions on the on the CPU side, which are executed atomically. Atomically means that the value is compared and set at the same time. For example, there is a test and set function, which will exchange or which will set a value to 1, but also retrieve the old value in the same time it executed that. So it will not just load, check, and then set. So it will do that all in one memory operation, which means that it can only execute once, because we only have one memory bus in our CPU side. So there is just one bus, there's only one main bus, only one instruction or only one data can be fetched at a time, or one instruction can be fetched at a time, not instruction, or one data can only be fetched one at a time. So this is be guaranteed to be synchronized, and in this case this will do some stuff. So with that lock you normally implement spin locks. With that atomic instruction you normally implement spin locks, and a spin lock, or actually I have called it ilock here because there are also other types of locks, will have three functions. One is acquire, which will just block until the object, the lock, could be acquired. We have a try acquire function, which will return if the lock has been acquired or not, and we have a release function, which will just release the lock so that the next one could acquire it again. There's a function called lockguard. The function lockguard will just make sure that the lock is acquired in the constructor and make sure that the lock will be released when called, or at least when the constructor, the destructor is called. Then I have a log object proxy. This is a object which guards access to a pointer. So it is created by a pointer and a reference to a log. The log will be put into a guard and directly acquired in the constructor of the log object proxy. And the log will be released on the destructor or on the release call, which will also invalidate the pointer to the data object. As long as this object is valid, so the data pointer is set, I can safely access the pointer through this access object, or this proxy, better to say. Locked object proxy in this case. Locked object proxy doesn't come out of nothing, it comes out of an object guard, which is based on a type. This is actually the type being guarded by this guard, and a type name LT. LT is called lock type, so this is actually needs to be a type name which inherits from the ilock interface, because we will use all the ilock's function on this. Or we will actually pass the ilock itself to the later onto the lock proxy object. So what this does, it just is created by putting in some T data or by calling T's default constructor. It also has some assign operations and all other stuff, which are also be guaranteed that it will be done atomically. But the main function we will use here is the get function, which returns a locked object proxy for T, which will acquire this lock and as soon as it is acquired, it will expose the M object in the locked object, and as soon as this locked object gets out of scope or gets destroyed or gets closed by calling release, it will release this lock again so that another lock object may be accessed to this M object data of type T. So, well, all that stuff just for guarding a specific object. How, no matter what type of object it is, it could be a class, it could be a simple variable, it could be anything, like you could put anything in that. And actually you just see, you would maybe now think there's something missing, and you're actually right. We just have a interface here, we just have the iLock here, but we don't have any implementation here. And the implementation is actually up to the user, and I actually put this out on purpose because the lock itself will, in the acquire function, will use the thread pause function, but I can't include the default header here, so I just pulled that out. And actually, this is actually good because you often want to have custom wait functions with you, especially if you have a job system. So we will now take a look at the implementation of a lock, and to be specific, the spin lock. Spin lock is just a very lightweight lock which is done on the user mode with a atomic instruction, like I already told you. It features the same functions like the other lock, and it is based on an atomic flag which has the main functions test and set and clear. We already talked about it in the last video. So here you actually see that the acquire is a while not try acquire function, and that this implementation is very straightforward and maybe one of the shortest class you have ever seen in your life. Yeah, okay, let's say one of the shortest production code class you have seen in your life. Yeah. So this is the spin lock and all the concurrent programming. Now we are going into the stuff of the video today, and actually we will do this the other way around than we did it in the last video. So we will go from the win main to the implementation, not from the implementation to the win main. Why is that? Because I want to show you what we want to do, and then we will actually see how we accomplish that. And this is actually in this case a bit better to understand, because you actually see how the dependency system works first, and after that you see the implementation, how it is actually done, that it is actually executed like this. And of course, when we are done with all the explanation today, we will actually look at this in inside graphics again, and then we can actually see the concept I explained with the pointers and the how many were that, four lists, which I've done on the one slide, with the several steps. So, what is our goal of today's video? I think I spoiled it last video, I'm not quite sure. We will actually today do an FPS killer. The FPS killer will just make sure that no frame is faster than 10 milliseconds. And you could now say, why would you do that? And I say, well, you wouldn't do that at all, but we will just do that here for testing. We are currently simulating a frame which takes 10 milliseconds on the GPU. How we will do that? Basically, the simulation of 10 milliseconds will be just a sleep of 10 milliseconds. But, well, let's just go a bit a step back and just look at the function. The function itself is called a static void FPS killer. It is static because it will be called in another thread, because this is what we want to do. We want to simulate the two operations that run in parallel on the CPU. So the FPS killer function does take a pointer to a wait object, to a XCOMMIT list wait object, and actually this pointer will be set down here by the function itself. It first creates an COMMIT list access object for a copy queue. So it wants to do copy operation in its thread, and well, the copy operations will take 10 milliseconds on the CPU side, so we will do some fancy hash functions maybe. We can do some hash iterations there to pull up the computation times. Yeah, and after we created that access object, we will actually create a wait object out of that access object. This is actually we don't know this function yet. Well, it just flags the access object dirty, because as soon as we have a wait object outside, we need to make sure that this comment list will actually be executed, because if we don't execute it, the dependency will never be resolved or resolved too late. And if the resolve would only occur in the next frame, we would actually block the current frame and we will have a deadlock in our application, which is not good. Now, the actual functionality of this function, well, it will just call the getUniversalWait object on the comment list, so just very straightforward. So, well, create wait object, create an access object, create a wait object out of that, and then set init OK to true. What is init OK? Init OK is just a static volatile bool, so, well, global scope init OK variable, which will just be false by default and will be iteratively every frame be set to false before this thread will be dispatched. And actually can see what happens. As soon as this pointer, or at least as soon as the data where this pointer is pointing to is valid, this init okay will be true. So this is actually the condition we will later see the when main is waiting for. And then I will do my eval block, because the blocking is always eval. You should never do that in production code, like sleep 1000 or something like this. Or well, actually, you could. This would be very interesting. You could keep this, and if you detect that the users are cheating, you could just do a sleep 100 and pull their FPS to infinity. No, not infinity in this case, to the ground. Pull your FPS to the ground. This would be actually quite funny. Let's maybe not. Yeah, actually, I think like 80 would be the nicest value, because it would be still kind of like playable, but it would be totally garbage to play the game. So actually, you could punish your cheaters by just giving them literally no FPS. Yeah, I will just sleep here, and after that I will execute. So any list that will be dependent on this list received by this access object will be delayed by 10 milliseconds, because this list itself is delayed. And this is actually where we will test our dependency. So by putting this value very high, we can actually make sure that we are really limited by the dependency. So how is this used inside the min main? Actually, here everything starts. First of all, I clear the init okay to false. Then I create an empty wait object. I create a thread which will execute the FPS killer function. And as a parameter, you get a pointer to this wait object. Now, while init okay is false, I will just loop. And after that, I am sure that this wait object now has been set to a correct wait object. So I can actually call my list access object and add a dependency on it to this wait object. Well, what add a dependency? We don't know this function yet. Well, it is not as complicated. We'll just call inject dependency on the comment list for our wait object. Actually, I think, should we mark it dirty here as well? I'm not quite sure. I think it will automatically resolve that. Well, just for convenience, just set the dirty flag here as well. So, okay. Come on. Yeah. It's just a bit better if we do that here. So, we will inject the dependency. We will look at this fee function later, but, well, I already told you we will inject the dependency, and in theory you know what is going on in the background, at least logically, not in code, but you should know what is going on there. After that, we do all the stuff we did like before. We will begin a frame, we will end a frame, and we will wait until the execution is done. And actually, this wait now implies waiting for that execute clause, because there's a dependency. So the execute exchange will actually not execute, but exchange. It will not execute the comment list, because it will block because of that dependency. But the dependency has already been ejected, so the wait object will not loop until infinity. So it will just loop until this execute will recursively execute the comment list received by this access object. And then we may get at sometimes a new iteration, and so a true evaluation of our wait function, and so a return out of this wait statement. After we have done that, we need to join to the user mode thread, which we create, or not user mode thread, because user mode thread would be fibers, to this kernel mode thread by calling thread join. And this will just make sure that this thread will really end. Actually, the thread join will not block at all, because, well, when it executes, it will return. And because execute, or the wait here, implies that we did execute the list, the thread will be terminated. So, we'll now take a look at how this application will perform. Already reading my calculator here. And NVIDIA overlay, are you with me? No, it is not. Is it again broken? Don't tell me that. No. Come back, NVIDIA, please. Ah, screw it. Guys, I actually don't know what is going on with that NVIDIA overlay. Last time we had the FPS, but not the overlay. This time we have the fucking overlay, but not the FPS. You see, FPS counter is there. It is there. But what does it does here? Nothing. Again, I today recorded the German video just a few hours ago, and everything worked fine. Ah. Well, let's just help with Inside Graphics here. Well, here we have Inside Graphics up and running, and we actually can see that we have like, let's say 85, 90 FPS, like, let's say 85, and we are at a frame time of like, like 12 milliseconds, and you can actually see that it is a bit more than the 10 we would expect, but this is actually quite fine because we also have some other stuff which is going on, because we are still doing the begin frame, end frame and present, which takes time as well. So this is totally legit, and we can actually see that we are performing very, very good. And we are really close at the 10 milliseconds, and we see that our dependency system seems to work. What the hazard is today going on? So now that we verify that everything works as expected, we're gonna take a look at the implementation. I have to warn you, I've changed some other things too, like the weight objects itself are a bit different now. If it is required to understand the new difference, we will take a look at it, but I don't want to explain every little detail I've done. Just to show you a few things that I have done, but not too much in detail. The comment queue now has an atomic flag. Well, I could have used the spin lock there now too, because I implemented them, but I didn't did it here now, but okay, it's okay. I have an atomic flag here, which is to guard the execution on the queue, because I just want that all the wait, execute, signal stuff is all grouped together according to the comment list, so I just have some locking and unlocking here, which just is some atomic stuff here again, but not quite too complicated in the implementation. We already talked about the changes in the comment list access object, so no difference here. There is a small change in the comment list manager, and it is just in the execute, or better to say lock list function, unlock list, sorry. And while executing a comment list, we now also pass the fence pointer, so the fence array, better to say, to the execute function. And this is required because we need to mainly to wait for a fence, and we will see why this is required in the comment list implementation, which we are just switching to now. So here we are inside the comment list header file. First of all, you see that we are now using spin locks, and that we have a new define here. The define defines the maximum dependencies for a list, or also in reverse, the maximum number of dependents a comment list has, or the maximum number that other lists can depend on one list. And in our case, this is 128, which should be plenty, really plenty. We shouldn't have that much. We also have a new struct here, actually a templated struct, very, very fancy here. And it is just the x comment list dependence list, which will just have a UN64 dependence count and an array of dependents, so array of x comment list pointer of the size n, so there comes your template parameter into play. And we also have a static const expression function here, unsigned in size, where we will just return n, so a very small inliner here just to get n out of any object, so that I don't have to copy paste all the values, or so that I don't have to rely on macros. So I can use macros to create them with size, but I don't have to use macros in the code, which would be okay in our case, but it is a bit better if we do it like this. It is a const expression, so it will be automatically done by the compiler. It's also static, so you actually don't need to have an instance of that object, which is all the nice thing we actually want. So now let's take a look at the new functions of the X comment list. These are actually two functions that are exposed externally. One is has dependency, which will just return true if the list itself has dependencies. And we have a inject dependency function, which takes a reference to a wait object, a X comment list wait object, to actually inject a dedicated, or let's not just say dedicated, a unresolved, a strong dependency inside this list. Well, internally there are a bit more functions. It's a resolve dependency function, which will be actually called recursively if it is required by the execute function, which will also have a pointer to the array of fences, which is be passed by the comment list manager. This is required because we may recursively need to call execute again, and so we have to pass on this array. And we have an unsigned fence page. This will just tell an index into which fence needs to be weighed on, and also the value the fence needs to be weighed on. This fence space will be 0, 1 or 2 in our case, so it will be direct, copy or compute, and it's just the type index for type, which represents the current fence index. So actually an index inside this array for what to weight in this array. The set resolve dependency function is the same like the resolve dependency function, just that it only stores the fence page and the, well, stores this fence value internally for that specific fence page. So this will actually atomically compare, exchange a value and make sure that the maximum fence value for that fence page is internally stored. Speaking of that storing here, it is actually stored inside this array. This is an array of SCD atomic 0 and 64, or actually to say SCD atomic U long long. It is just an array of several elements, actually number of queues, so 3, so that the index 1, 2, and 1, 0, and I can't count. 0, 1, and 2 are actually valid inside this array, and it will just store the maximum call to set resolve dependency for that fence as index to that array, and this fence value as std max on this value and the already stored value. Actually, you could say, why do you need this? Actually, we need this because the resolving on a std atomic of type int is a bit more undertaking than just setting a value to an std max. So I just wrote a function because this is called from several points in the program or from several points in the comment list, so that it is a bit more easy to use and we don't have so many duplicated code. We also have another free function here. It is called insert dependent. Insert dependent is actually kind of like the inverse of inject dependency, because inject dependency will call insert dependency on the comment list behind this wait object with itself as the comment list pointer. So this is kind of like the reverse link, which does the hey comment list A be dependent on comment list B. So I would call A inject dependency clammer of B, and internally it will call B pointer or B pointer to B execute insert dependent onto A. So this is like the reverse linking. This atomic value here, it's just a normal unsend it, is the dependencies count. This will count how many lists need to be resolved, or how many resolves are required until this list is executed. So this will just make sure that, because we are using reverse linking, that we don't execute and keep track how many dependencies we self have. It's also atomic and it will be incremented just like a normal it, because atomic allows us to. Well, now comes the nice shit. This is now a X comment list dependent list of the CLSDX X comment list max dependency, so a X comment dependency list of size 128. So this is our array where we store which comment lists are dependent on us. And because this may be executed or accessed in parallel, because it may be inject dependencies from bronze thread while another thread tries to resolve dependencies with that, because it has been executed. So we actually need to guard this to concurrent access, and this is done by our empty object guard. And this empty object guard will be actually of the type empty spin lock. So this object guard will use a spin lock for guarding that object, which is a comment list dependency list at size 128, and it is called mdependence. Well, a bit much, but yeah, let's just look at the implementation. It might be a bit more clear if we take a look at the implementation. Let me first of all check the inject dependency function. It will just assert that if the pointer inside the dependency wait object is the same pointer as the function you're currently calling, so if you want to make A dependent of A, for example, then the wait object needs to have a lower iteration count than the current iteration, or at least the same iteration count. So A can be dependent on A if the wait object of A, which tries to be injected into A, has been created in a former or in the same frame. Because if the dependency or the iteration count would be higher, then this would mean that the comment list would never be able to execute, and this is not allowed, so this is asserted here in debug mode at least. Well, after that we have to determine when we actually need to insert the dependency. Because while the access object may be passed around, it could also be possible that it is already done executing, so we don't need to insert the dependency because it already finished executing. So I use that by checking is done on the wait object and the X comment list wait object, which will yield true as soon as it is already done on the GPU. So I will only record or insert the dependency if I'm not done on this wait object. Also, I will check that the pointers mismatch, because if I'm putting a dependency from A to A, I've already asserted that it is a lower or equal. So a lower or equal means I don't have to add some wait statements. They will be cancelled out after that either. So I will just assert that I don't do all that expensive insert dependent call. So now the insert dependent call is be called on the pointer inside the dependency object. So inside the wait object, there we have the pointer. Actually, I had to make the X comment list friend of the wait object to access that pointer. But this is no problem in this case. So I will actually just call the insert dependent because, well, this is now dependent on that list. So on that list, I say inject or insert dependency. I also have to pass the dependency itself because according to that dependency, after the internal object has been locked, I will determine if the execute is still be required or if I may are already executing and already have a weak dependency for that object here. So it is required here as well. And also the sys pointer so that the m comment list pointer knows which list is dependent on it. How does this is insert dependent works? First of all, it will get and also lock the dependence. So this is atomically, I can be sure that this auto dependence list, which is the empty lock object proxy of type dxx comment list dependence list of size 128. So this is kind of like this proxy object I've told you what lived inside the lock tools. And this will just make sure that only one object has access to this m dependence guarded object. So after I am sure that I am the only one who has the access, I am I'm doing some other stuff. I will now try to convert the wait object, the list wait object, to a fence wait object. Well, this was not possible before, but is possible now, because if we take a look at this new function I've implemented, it will only do this in several cases. It will only do this when the list is executing, because if when the list is executing, this means that I can generate a fence value, because now the list is already executing. This could happen because I will not get notified until now because I wasn't injected there. But if while I'm inside this injecting process, the comment list finishes, I have a problem. So I have to check this here again. And actually checking here is now safe, because now the list of this current list, which I am checking with that statement, is locked. So if it would try to resolve its dependency, it would need to wait until I am with that function done, and that function would have the opportunity to inject the dependency onto the list, free or release the lock again, and then the resolve function would correctly already resolve the current list in flight. So I just assert that the state is queue executing, and it will check that the state is queue executing. And also another case is possible: if the m value is smaller than the current iteration value of the list, this also means that the list is currently executing and that everything works fine. So I can then safely return the get execution wait object without having to worry that the execution wait object has been created on the last execute value. So I now have, or have not, a wait object. So actually there are now two cases when the function can succeed. One case is that the wait object in this case was in existence. It means I don't have to insert the dependency because it already has been executed. This means that the function can execute. Or the other case is that the dependency count is or the dependence count is lower than the size of the dependence list, which means I have some space to insert. So succeed means this function is evaluated nicely. So I can then return succeed in this case, or true or false back down here. So what operation is done now is now dependent on the succeed and the wait object value. Well, if I'm succeed, this means that the list at least has a slot and the wait object is not in existence, which makes sure that the list has a slot. Then now I can insert. I will insert at the position dependent count because it starts at zero, and well, the array also starts at the zero. And after that, I can increment the dependence count in this case. And what I also have to do, I have to follow the pointer comment list, which was given here, and increment its dependency count, which again is an atomic, so the increment in this case is no problem. That I now can call here, increment the other dependencies count as well, which is required because it has to be at least at a value so that it will not be straightly executed. So do all that stuff, set the pointer, increment both dependency counts, my and the other ones, and then go on. Else, if I not succeeded because, well, I hadn't a slot or the wait object was in existence, I check again if the wait access was in existence. I actually could also check for success here, which may be a bit more convenient to tell what is going on here. So, yeah, no, let's just do the wait object because I'm using it, so It actually don't matter because it, yeah, it's okay. When now the weight object is in existence, I actually need to resolve the dependency on the comment list because when it tried to inject a strong dependency, but a strong dependency already has become a weak dependency, so I actually need to resolve the weak dependency here. I just get the index at type again so that I know the fence page. And what I now can do is I need to increment the other's dependency count because I call resolve and the set resolve dependency. No, actually, the set resolve dependency does nothing. This is actually bullshit here. Let me just get rid of this again. The set resolve dependency function, the other. Okay, this the incrementation here was very wrong. I did some misunderstanding here. I just mixed something up in my head because I'm currently not in the execution process. I'm into the injection progress, so I don't need to make sure that these things actually decrement refs. And actually, this is the exchange function which we now take a look at, which is currently not required. So this on the I call on the other commentlets which I passed in here, which tries to build up a dependency. I call a function called setResolveDependency because I can resolve a dependency because this weightObject is in existence, and I will actually set this to the list type index of myself and my current fence head because I'm currently executing because, well, the weightObject here is a weightObject of myself, so I can just use my head here of my counter or of my fence count frontend and just resolve a dependency here. How does this resolve dependency work? So you remember that this has to be done atomically, but we are doing a max operation, which means that we need to load onto the registers of the CPU though a comparison, and according to that comparison store back one of the value, for example the old one or the new one, matters on which was bigger. And because we are using the CPU registers, we are going out of the scope of atomic operation, which is bad because when we load and do the comparison, a bigger value than myself new value and the old value could already been put onto the real atomic value or the real register which we are trying to access atomically, and then all of our atomics is done and we have a hazard and a problem in there. So we need to do a bit of a compare exchange here. So what we are doing, we are just firstly defining a old value and a new value. The old value will just be loaded from the array of weight dependencies and exactly at this slot fence page, because for that value we are looking, and we will load that. After that, the new value can be set. The new value is the maximum of the old value or the fence value, so just the maximum here. So we still have our old value, which we suppose to have not been changed in the register, and we have the new value. So what we actually do is, this is in a do loop, so this will actually repeat until a specific condition is met, and this condition which has to be met is the compare execute exchange at the same slot we have read the value of before. Compare exchange is actually quite a nice function. It takes in two main parameters, one expected value and one desired value. How does this function work? First of all, it will atomically check the data register. Is the will value equal to the old value? If yes, put in the new value. If not, put not in the new value and return false. So as long as this returns false, so as long as the old value does not match, we do get back the new old value, we compute the new value, we check again, has the old value been changed? Yes, okay, let's do it again. Has the old value changed? No, it has not been changed. Okay, put in the new value and return. So this will just try until it succeeds with exchanging the value like it was expected. Now we take a look at the real resolve dependency function. It's actually quite easy to understand. It takes in the array of fences. I already told you why this is required, the fence page and the fence value. First of all, I just assert that I have dependencies, because if I don't have dependencies, a resolve would be pointless. So after that, I just can call the set resolve dependency function, which was already called by the insert dependent if the insert was not required. So it will just set the fence page and the fence value as expected. After that, I will just decrement my dependency count, and if my dependency now count, my dependency count is now zero and I am closed. Remember, the closed state means that the comment list was closed and awaits execution, but has not been executed because it had a dependency count. So it has to be a closed state, and the dependency counter has to be null, so that we can then call recursively execute, which again calls, as we will see in a few seconds, which will call resolve on all dependent lists, which may call execute on other on itself again, which may again recursively go dependencies, and this is actually here our our recursing loop. And actually you see that this recursion is not just as you may have already saw it, like in some calculations where a recursive function only calls itself. So actually it's like this, execute on one list calls resolve on other lists, which may call execute on themselves, which may call resolve on other lists. So it's a bit of a like execute resolve, so not just resolve, 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 it's execute resolve, so the recursion is not there at the first point of view, but it is definitely in there. Now we take a look at the execute function. First of all, I check if I have dependency. As soon as I have dependency, I just return an empty wait object and that is it. No, nothing to do here more, because if I have dependency, I don't have to execute. After this, you already should know that I will get my types and check my states. After that, I will lock the comment queue, because I will just make sure that I'm doing these steps in order on the comment queue. And after these steps will be done, I will unlock bat again, of course. And in these steps, I will generate several wait conditions. They can be up to 3 in our case, so for 1, for 0, 1 and 2. So for all types of queues, there is a potential wait condition that needs to be met. First of all, I will check that our type is not the I type, because if it is the same type, then the dependency is already resolved by the fact that the list is currently being staged for execution. So all dependencies are already executed on the GPU, so I don't have to put in a wait state. And on all other index arrays, I will just check that at the index I actually is a value, because if there is no value, so if there is 0, then this means that there is no dependency at all and we also don't need a wait here. So in case this is not our index and we actually have a wait value, we will actually execute and wait on our phase, on our queue with the offense given in that array at the index I here, and at the for the value at this array, so our SCD atomic ulong, or atomic ulonglong, which is our uint64 array at type E. So this is just a wait condition. After that, we can do our old and well-known execute and signal, unlock it back again, and then we need to clear our states and follow all dependency. First of all, I will clear all resolved, all weak dependencies back to 0 by using the store function of the array wait dependencies. And after that, I will resolve all dependencies. First of all, I get my dependence with the get function, which just makes sure that nobody else has access to it, so I have exclusive access to them. Then I will just loop over this array while I have dependence count. I will just go at dependence count minus 1 because it is 0 based, and I will resolve the dependencies for the array given for my type, because now I'm resolving for my myself, so I have to take also my fence page in here, and also for my current fence front and head, which is the value being signaled here. So I will just recursively now go on to resolving dependencies, and after that I also have to decrement my dependence count so that this while loop will end at some times. After this while iteration is done, I will just release this dependence list again, because my function will not straight to return. I will do some more stuff here, so I just make sure that everything works as planned, and then I can set my state back to queue executing, and then I can return a get execution wait object, which is just a default wait object. Well, now all that stuff is done, and we are done with explaining. I will show you some two more things. Actually, first of all, I will show you that I will show you that actually our wait is the one which is blocking us out, which is the proof I have been left over to you until now. So I will just at the start the Visual Studio Performance Analyzer. This will just take a look at our program. We will just let it run a few seconds here, and this will just analyze which functions has taken the most time. So I will just alt F4 here out. It will just do some calculation on its own. It will actually tell us where our problem or our performance loss in our application was. And actually you can see that our performance loss is inside the winmain. Inside the winmain, our EXPP invoke is there. This is our exception safe invoke. And after that, there was the swinmain, which has taken the most CPU execution time, 95%. So if we take a look at, we can click at it and open up the call stack, and we can actually see here that the next biggest value is only like 17%. So we actually now know that the most time is spent inside our winmain. To find the place where we are spending our time in the winmain, we can just, we can just scroll through the peak window here, and we will actually see this highlighted. We see that this is big and red, and this is actually our wait condition. This is just like expected. We are waiting here for the other thread to finish, which is a bit more than 10 milliseconds, because we already also want to wait until this is done on the GPU. So there is our performance decreased, and this is actually totally right. This is where our performance is going. Yeah, just to make sure that this is all right. So now I switch back to NZ Graphics, and I will just take a capture of our frame so that we can actually look how things went on the GPU. So I will just take a capture here, and there we go. Back to NZ Graphics, events view. And now we can take a look how things went. Actually, we will now also take a look at this thread ID here. So first of all, let me check the recording of comment list. First, we started recording our comment list 1, which is right, because we have done the begin frame and end frame on here. After that, actually, you could see that our comment list 1 got closed here, but it got not executed because, well, there were dependencies on the comment list. But actually now here you can see that here is also a closed statement. This is now from another thread ID, and it is on another comment list, and the comment list 65, which is actually our first copy comment list. And you can actually see that there was also a close. And straightly after that close, you also find an execute on the same thread and on the same comment list, because it's the comment queue 2 in this case, which is the copy comment queue. I don't know where we can get information, but this is actually our copy comment queue. You see that we now here have an execute, and after this execute, we also have a signal on that comment queue. And you know that signal is the last thing which is in our execute function, and after the signal, we are going to resolve with the same thread and try to find any dependent comment list. And this is actually what happened here. You see that the next step on the GPU is on comment queue 1, and it is a wait for the fence 2, which is the same fence which has been signaled in the operation above, and also with the same value. So this is actually the resolve, and with the resolve, because we only had one dependency, the direct recursive execute of our comment list 1 on the comment queue 1. So you can see there was the wait, here was the execute with our comment list 1 on our comment queue 1. Then there were all the comments on our comment list 1. They were directly executed, because you see begin of end comment list of comment list 65 was here, because there were no operations, so it directly worked after the execute. And so here we didn't have to wait until stuff finished, so we just had here all the comment list 1 again, and again also the signal of our comment list 1, which is actually directly computed with the directly finished with the signal. And the thing to remember, you see that they are still all of these calls are still on our second thread, on our FPS killer thread with the number 10,020. And after that has been finished, all that stuff, all the two executed finished on the second thread, our third thread comes back in here, our thread 53088, and iteratively checks our execution value until we are done and the main thread calls present again. So you can actually see that everything worked like explained on the video or on the presentation. So our application is just performing like we are expecting it to. And this is really nice. And now we can actually see that our dependency works, and these are all pre-requirements we need for an actual dedicated resource management and memory management on the GPU. So I hope you understand everything right. I know it's a bit hard, and this is DirectX 12, so it's the curse of DirectX 12. So, but have a nice day. We see us in the next video. Bye.